Well, hey guys, we had some technical difficulties last night as far as broadcasting the service goes. So I thought what I would do today would go back to our Wednesday in the Word, but on a Thursday, and go over the verses that I taught in prayer meeting last night for those of you who couldn't be there, so that you're still in the flow as we continue to go through the pastoral epistles. So last night we started 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy written by Paul to Timothy. Timothy's still in Ephesus, but Paul finds himself in a very difficult situation. He has been rearrested. He is in a kind of a dark, dank, you know, dungeon kind of situation. And it's the last book he's going to write. He is going to lose his life. You know, this is the last thing he does before he's killed for his faith. And so it's really sort of a last will and testament. It's his last word. And there are several times where he really, you can tell he knows, and, you know, I'm being poured out, drink offering, you know, all those things that he talks about. So, and is going to really encourage Timothy to be faithful. So we looked at the first 7 verses last night of 2 Timothy. So let me read those and then we'll just walk through them together. This is 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, according to the promise of life in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve with a clear conscience, the way my forefathers did, as I constantly remember you in my prayers night and day, longing to see you, even as I recall your tears, so that I may be filled with joy. For I'm mindful of the sincere faith within you, which first dwelt in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am sure that it is in you as well. For this reason, I remind you to kindle afresh the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has not given us a spirit of timidity, but of power and love and discipline. So really, I mean, I don't think I'm centered up here, so maybe that's better. I don't know. But that's where it's going to stay. Here, Paul is writing really to encourage Timothy, and all throughout the book, he's going to do that. And so in these first 7 verses, he's going to remind Timothy of his spiritual gifts and that he's to use them for God's glory. So let's just kind of go a few verses at a time, see how Paul starts this letter, so that as we go through, we can catch the tone of it. He starts out and he says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, according to the promise of life in Christ Jesus. Paul mentions that he is an apostle. That means that he has an authority that no longer exists today. Those first century, first generation apostles had an authority to appoint elders and to speak with an authority that no one has today. This office no longer exists. And Paul had to constantly defend his apostleship because he wasn't one of the 12. He wasn't somebody who had followed Jesus from the time of John the Baptist until the resurrection. However, he had encountered the risen Christ on the road to Damascus. He had been commissioned by Christ himself. So he was that authoritative apostle. He held that office, that gift that God gave. He mentions that office in Ephesians 4, I believe it is. So that's who Paul is. He has the authority to talk to Timothy, to appoint elders, to appoint other people to appoint elders, and all these things. That's who he is. He is an apostle. So Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, so he's following the Lord, by the will of God. If you go back and look, it's interesting, God's plan for Paul, when Paul encountered Christ on the road to Damascus, as more details are given in the book of Acts, you know, it happens in about around Acts 9, Paul encounters Christ on the road, he's struck blind, you know, there's Ananias and all that. And then 2 more times in Acts, we get the same story where Paul's giving his testimony and he gives more detail. As he gives us more detail, we learn at some point that through Ananias, God tells Paul, you're going to suffer. This is my plan for you as a servant. So God had a purpose, a plan, a will for Paul's life. And ultimately, Paul's writing this from jail. He is suffering. He will die for his faith. So he is an apostle by the will of God. This is God's choice in Paul's life. He says, according to the promise of life in Christ Jesus. He's an apostle first because he's a believer. And because he's a believer, God has this calling on his life to do this special thing. So then here's who he's writing to. To Timothy, my beloved son. And he finishes up verse 2. Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. He calls Timothy his son there. They had that kind of father-son relationship. Paul would have been in his late 60s when this letter was written. Paul is normally about the same age as the year. That's a good way to think about Paul's life. So if it's AD 50, Paul's about 50. Here it's about AD 66, AD 67, maybe 68. So Paul's 66, you know, to 68, somewhere in that age. Timothy probably right around 30 or so. So there's a father-son difference in their ages, and that's the relationship that they had. We encounter Timothy on Paul's second missionary journey, and then he becomes one of the traveling companions, and he's raised up, really. So Paul loves him like a son when he says that. Of course, they're brothers in Christ, but they then have that father-son type relationship. He says in verse 3, I thank God, whom I serve with a clear conscience, the way my forefathers did, as I constantly remember you in my prayers night and day. Paul in jail can say, my conscience is clear. It's very interesting. I imagine he had the, you know, Paul's human like everybody else. There had to be times where he's there and he's in jail and he's chained up and it's dark and it's gross and, you know, all those things. He's thinking, this guy's got punishing me. Did I mess up somewhere? You know, but that's not what he does. His conscience is clear. He knows he has served God to the fullest. He knows he's done what God has called him to do. And so he's thinking along those same lines as he's praying for Timothy. One of the things that really stood out to me as I was going through this is Paul's in jail, and I think he knows the end of life is near, and yet he's telling Timothy, I pray for you night and day. Paul is one of the most selfless people that we encounter in the Bible, probably one of the most selfless people in the history of Christianity. This is a guy that God used to do amazing things, to get the gospel to Europe, to get it to, you know, the Roman Empire, to stand in front of kings and Caesar and everyone. And yet his concern at the end of life is not, hey, look what I've done. Well, look who I've stood in front of. Look how many churches I've started. His concern is, Timothy, I'm praying for you. So it's a very selfless thing. It's Christ-like, because that's what Christ did for us. He put us first. He went to the cross on our behalf. And that's Paul is emulating his Lord here. So he says in verse 4, longing to see you, even as I recall your tears, so that I may be filled with joy. He wants to see Timothy, so Paul will be filled with joy, but he's remembering that Timothy's had some struggles, he's had some tears, he's had some difficulties, and Paul just wants to encourage him in that. He needs to be encouraged. Timothy was there in Ephesus, there was false teaching, things he had to combat, the church was a mess at times. That's why in 1 Timothy, you have all the qualifications for pastor and deacon, you know, to make sure the right people were in place. So Timothy did not have an easy ministry in Ephesus, and so Paul's trying to build him up and to encourage him. He says, I long to see you. I wish I could see you. And I remember what you're going through. That's why he's praying for him day and night, because he knows about those tears, those things that Timothy's struggling with. So Paul, back to the selflessness, brings in the encouragement by way of reminder. Look at verse 5. For I am mindful of the sincere faith within you. So he starts with, Timothy, I know you love Jesus. And here's where it started. Which first dwelt in your grandmother Lois. So his grandmother was a believer, and your mother Eunice, so she was a believer, and I'm sure that it is in you as well. He says, Timothy, you come from a long line of people who serve the Lord. Keep doing what you saw your grandmother model, what you saw your mother model, what you are modeling and demonstrating to the people around you. Keep on going. Keep doing what God has called you to do. Specifically, he's going to talk about in a moment, use your gifts. Those gifts that God has given you, Timothy, those spiritual gifts that he has presented to you to use for the kingdom, keep at it. Keep using those. Because he says in verse 6, for this reason, I remind you to kindle afresh. That sort of keep the spark going, in other words. Kindle afresh the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. Apparently, at the laying, when hands were laid on Timothy as the ordination sort of thing for his ministry, some prophecy was made about Timothy and what he was going to do and how he was going to serve the Lord. In fact, 1 Timothy 4:14, Paul talks about it. He says, do not neglect the spiritual gift within you, which is bestowed on you through prophetic utterance with the laying on of hands by the presbytery. It's a hard word to say, especially for a Baptist. It's hard for a Baptist to say presbytery. I imagine Presbyterians are better at it, but I don't know. I've never asked one. And so something happened at that moment when Timothy was being, they were laying hands on him, setting him apart to serve as a missionary, as a pastor, you know, all those different roles that he served in, that somebody said, hey, this guy, and the Holy Spirit let everybody know, this guy is gifted in this way. It wasn't through the laying on of hands that the gift came. What happened was in the moment of the laying on of hands, the gift was revealed to everybody saying, this is who this is. This is how I'm going to use Timothy. We're not told specifically what that is. And yet we see that Timothy, God used him to bring organization and to appoint elders and all of those things. There's a lot of different, you know, leadership gifts and, you know, evangelism and all those things that could be associated with that. But Timothy knows exactly what Paul's talking about because he was there. It's about him. So he's saying, keep that fresh, keep it kindled, keep that fire burning. And then he wraps it up in verse 7. He says, for God has not given us a spirit of timidity. In other words, Timothy, we're not to be timid in the use of our gifts, but of power and love and discipline. The power means that God empowers us to use our spiritual gifts. He empowered Timothy to use his. He empowers us to use ours. But we do it with a sense of love. Others come first. There's not a sense of arrogance. There's not a sense of pride when it comes to our spiritual gifts. And then he mentions discipline or self-control. We don't use our gifts to manipulate people. We don't use our gifts to sort of lift ourselves up. We use it simply for the kingdom of God. So a sense of God has gifted us, he's empowered us, and we do that with love and self-control. So here's my sentence, right? Here's the point. You always got to try to wrap some, make sure anytime you study a paragraph, you want to be able to sum it up in one sentence. That's for, you know, any of you guys who teach the word out there should always be able to wrap up your lesson. If somebody said, what's your lesson about today? You should be able to give a clear, complete sentence of here's what's going on. Here's the point. And here's what I came up with. God empowers us to use our spiritual gifts with love and self-control. That's what he's encouraging Timothy. Let me read it again. God empowers us to use our spiritual gifts with love and self-control. If you've repented of your sins and placed your faith in Christ, you have spiritual gifts. And God, through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, will empower you to use them for the kingdom. And so you and I are to kindle afresh, just like Timothy is, those gifts that are in us and use them for his glory. So, well, guys, that is 2 Timothy 1 through 7, an encouragement really to Timothy to remember what had happened in the past and that all those gifts and all that promise had not changed, that God hadn't changed. And he's to remember what his grandmother and mother were like and remember who Paul is and that Paul's praying for him. And he's to faithfully serve. And that's what you and I are to do. We're to simply use our gifts that God has given us to serve the kingdom, to serve the local church, to serve other believers, to serve the lost so that they come to faith in Christ. That's what we are called to do. Well, guys, that is Wednesday in the Word. But on a Thursday, because of some crazy technical difficulties, we had the phones updated on us. Bill was out and showed me how to get everything going. And then the cell phones, you know, had a software update and I couldn't get stuff connected. And I thought, well, we'll just do this tomorrow. It was time to start prayer meeting anyway. So hopefully this helps and catches everybody up as far as what we're doing on Wednesday night. So, well, guys, that is Wednesday in the Word on Thursday. And so we will hopefully see y'all on Sunday morning for Sunday school and next Wednesday night as well for prayer meeting. See y'all then.